In this video, you see a water droplet falling on the surface of the water and creating ripples that spread out. Now, what did we learn in our first lecture about ripples and water droplets? Yes, this motion is wave motion. Now, what did we learn about a wave? A wave is a vibratory disturbance that carries energy from one point to another without there being any direct contact between the two points. So, how many types of waves did we learn there are? There are two types of waves: transverse waves and longitudinal waves. So, let's take a quick recap of the definitions. In transverse waves, the vibration of the particles is in a direction perpendicular to the motion of wave propagation. And in longitudinal waves, the vibration of the particles is in a direction that is the same as the direction of propagation. So this is the definition of a transverse wave. As you can clearly see, in transverse wave, the particles vibrate about their mean position in a direction that is perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the wave. So what are some examples of transverse waves? Waves that are formed on the surface of the water when you throw a stone, or waves that are formed when you shake a rope up and down that is fixed at one end. So this animation shows that even though the disturbance is traveling in the forward direction, the particles are vibrating in their mean position in an up and down manner. Thus, we can clearly see that the direction is perpendicular. So, this animation also clearly illustrates how the disturbance in a transverse wave travels from one point to the other. You will see that there is no direct contact between one end and the other. So, you must recall the cork and stone experiment that we did previously. Let us perform that experiment again. What we do is, we place a piece of cork in still water. Notice that this dotted line denotes still water. We place the cork and obviously nothing happens. Now we throw a large object like a shoe or a big stone into the water. Now there are huge ripples that spread out in the water. What do you find? You will find that the cork does not change its position. That is weird, right? Yet you will see that the cork bobbles up and down about its mean position. So what is this? The moment the shoe or stone is thrown, the molecules at that point are disturbed and start vibrating to and fro about their mean position. This kinetic energy is transferred by this molecule to the next molecule, and that also starts vibrating to and fro. In this way, the disturbance is carried from one end to the other. As the molecules are not moving from their position, the cork remains in its position, but it travels, it bobbles in an up and down motion. And obviously, there is no contact between this end and this end. Now, what do we do if we want to plot the movement of the water particles on a graph? In this example, we consider one particle and we map its movement on a graph. The animation that you see has been shown considering just one particle. So the moment you throw the shoe into the water, the disturbance is created and the water molecules start moving up and down. So consider just one molecule. The moment the shoe is thrown into the water, the molecule starts from its mean position and starts moving up. It moves up to a certain distance and then stops. Let us say that this upward distance is shown on the positive side of the y-axis, as we can see on this graph. Now, the particle, after reaching the top, has a tendency to come back to its mean position. So it starts coming back to its mean position, but due to the presence of the disturbance, it continues beyond its mean position and keeps moving downwards. This downward motion is shown by the negative movement of the graph that we see over here. The downward movement is shown on the negative y-axis. Now, when the particle reaches down, it again has a tendency to go up to its mean position. So what the particle does is it starts moving back up. This entire movement has been represented by this graph, as we can see in this animation over here. This maps the movement of one particle. Similarly, we can map the movement of other particles as well. Now, you will see in this animation that there are many particles which are executing similar up and down motions that you saw in the previous animation. So here you see, the moment the first particle starts moving up, the next particle also starts moving up the very next instance. And in a similar way, all the neighboring particles are excited. So here, the displacement of several particles has been mapped with the distance from the origin. So what happens if we are to take a snapshot of this entire animation, that is, at a particular time? Let us consider the droplet falling on the water surface once more. Here we find that when the ripples are spreading out, if I freeze the frame over here, you will find that the disturbances are occupying a particular place on the water surface. This is frozen in time, and the disturbances are shown by the dark and light areas around the ripples. Now, if I allow the disturbances to travel forward and freeze the frame again, you will find that the disturbances that I showed you earlier have moved outwards, and the disturbances that were previously inwards have moved outwards. So what does this tell you? That the disturbance is continuously traveling outwards, but the particles keep vibrating only about their mean position. Now, let me give you a little additional information. As you have seen in a transverse wave, the particles vibrate up and down in their mean position. So, the maximum displacement on either side of the mean position, as you recall, was called amplitude. The positive displacement of the particle from its mean position, the maximum, is known as a crest. And the maximum negative displacement, or the minimum displacement of the particle from its mean position, is known as a trough. And this black line denotes the line of zero disturbance. That is, the black line is the mean position. Now, let us talk about longitudinal waves. Consider the slinky being shown in the example over here. This slinky is being pushed and pulled by a man, and the other end of the slinky is fixed. You will notice that the disturbance is traveling along the length of the slinky. When the disturbance travels, some parts of the slinky, as you see, are coming closer, and other parts of the slinky remain far apart. So when the disturbance travels, the parts of the slinky that are coming close to one another are known as compressions, and the parts of the slinky that are far apart from one another are known as rarefactions. So what was a longitudinal wave definition? A longitudinal wave is a wave in which particles of the medium vibrate back and forth in the direction of wave propagation. So if the particle is vibrating back and forth in this direction, the direction of wave propagation will be the same. Consider the particles shown in red, marked by the arrows. Here you will find that they are vibrating back and forth about their mean position. But the disturbance is traveling in the forward direction, in the same direction as particle vibration, in from one end to the other end. In this image, you will find compressions and expansions or rarefactions explained. As you saw in the case of the slinky, the parts of the slinky which come together are known as compressions. And as the compression moves ahead, it leaves behind parts of the slinky which are far away from one another. This is known as a rarefaction. So, just as we represented a transverse wave on a graph, can we do the same for a longitudinal wave? Let us find out. For a longitudinal wave, consider again the particle marked by the red arrow. You will find that the particle is moving back and forth about its mean position due to a disturbance. So, when the particle starts moving from its mean position forward due to disturbance, we mark that on the positive side of the y-axis. Now the particle keeps moving forward, goes a certain distance and stops. Now here also the particle has a tendency to return to its mean position. So it starts coming back to its mean position. But since the disturbance is still present, it does not stop at the mean position, but keeps going backwards. It goes backwards till a certain distance and then stops. Now the particle again wants to return to its mean position. So what does it do? It moves forward again and reaches the mean position. And this motion is repeated. The backward movement of the particle is represented on the negative side of the y-axis. So as you can see, the graphical representation of a longitudinal wave and a transverse wave is the same. So here we compare the movement of the slinky rings with the movement of the particles in a longitudinal wave. You will notice that when the slinky rings come together, which I said was a rarefaction, has been represented on the animation above. In this you see compressions take place when the particles become dense, and rarefactions take place when the particles are far apart from one another.